Hey everyone, welcome to week one of our James series. We're going to be walking through the book of James over the next 12 weeks, and I'm so glad to be doing this with you. We're going to start in James 1, and today we're going to be walking through 1 through 12. This is what James says. He says, James, a bondservant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes who are dispersed abroad, greetings. Consider it all joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. And let endurance have its perfect result, so that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. But if any one of you lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives to all generously and without reproach, and it will be given to him. But he must ask in faith without any doubting. For the one who doubts is like the surf of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. For that man ought not to expect that he will receive anything from the Lord, but being a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. But the brother of humble circumstances is to glory in his high position, and the rich man is to glory in his humiliation, because like flowering grass, he will pass away. For the sun rises with a scorching wind and withers the grass, and its flowers fall off, and the beauty of its appearance is destroyed. So too the rich man in the midst of his pursuits will fade away. But blessed is the man who perseveres under trial, for once he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life which the Lord has promised to those who love him. Now let me give you some context for this scripture. So James is the brother of Jesus, and he's talking to the very early church, to Jews who have given their lives to Jesus, who proclaim Jesus as Savior, and he calls them the 12 tribes who are dispersed. So they have been kicked out of their homes. They have been kicked out of the cities. They are under a lot of trials and under a lot of persecution. And he tells them right off the bat to count it all joy. It actually is a little grating, and it seems a little bit rude. It's a bit of an audacious proclamation. Hey, I know what you're going through right now is really awful, and I know it just kind of plain old sucks, but be happy. Have joy. One time I was walking through Walmart, and this like sample guy looked at me, and he said, hey, you dropped something back there. And I kind of looked around like, what? And he goes, your smile. And I swear, if looks could kill, the man would have been bleeding out on the floor. Like somebody telling you when you're in a bad mood to just be happy is downright annoying and frustrating. And that is the sense that you get from James right here off the bat. Like, hey, I know you've been kicked out of your homes. I know what you're going through is terrible. And you don't really know where your next meal might come from. But I want you to have joy. But here's what James does that's better than what that sample guy did. James actually tells them why they should have joy. Because joy is a foundation of what the Holy Spirit produces in our life. It is a fruit of the Spirit. And joy in difficult circumstances is actually a revealer of the Holy Spirit leading our lives and us not being led by our flesh, by our sinful nature. And here is what James says about what joy produces in our lives. The reason he says to have joy is because there's training in the trial. There is training for your life in the trial. In verse 3, James says, the testing of your faith produces endurance. The testing of your faith produces endurance. And this word for testing is not like you would think of in a school. It's not like with a pass or a fail that comes out of it. It is more like what you would see in a refiner of fine silver or of gold. And what they do is they put this metal over fire for the purpose of refining it. And as it is melted down, all the impurities rise to the top, and they will take those off the top. They'll allow it to cool, and then they'll go through the process again, because it starts off with a whole bunch of impurities in it, with a whole bunch of junk mixed in with the silver. But as they refine it, it becomes more and more pure, until finally that silversmith can see his own reflection and the silver, it has become so pure. And that's what this trial is supposed to be like in our life. It is supposed to refine our faith. I think of the most refining times for my faith, and they have come under the greatest moments of trial where I've got to decide, do I believe that God is who he says he is? Do I believe his word? Or do I believe that these circumstances are greater than who God says he is? And it requires a new kind of faith and a new kind of endurance to press through this. So James is saying, have joy because the trial builds endurance of your faith. Like John Maxwell says, everything worthwhile is uphill. The thing about trials is as you are running them, they make your legs burn and they make your lungs hurt. And it is not easy. You wish there was a path around it rather than up and over it. But no one ever becomes a world-class athlete without training. And nobody ever becomes a giant in the faith without building endurance, an endurance of our faith. And I know it's our natural instinct to withdraw, to resist the pain and the trial, to even curse the day that we are experiencing. But in the hands of our good God, we are assured that God will do what he says in Romans 8:28, that he will work all things for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose. And that is you. You are called according to his purpose. So we can cling to that scripture that he works all things for our good, that the endurance is producing something good in us. And so since we are created with a purpose, since we are called by God to be his followers, you need that endurance for this next thing. And this is the next thing that James says comes out of the trial and the reason we can have joy. And that is because endurance determines effectiveness. Our endurance determines our effectiveness. This is what he says in verse 4. He says, so let endurance have its perfect result so that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. I want you to know that what is ahead of you is greater than what was behind you. And what you are going towards needs the skills that you are developing in this season. What the Lord has for you in the future needs the endurance that you are developing in this season. It is not a dress rehearsal. This is not like you're not just practicing building endurance so that in the future you can build the real endurance. No, this trial right here, right now, is so that you can build real endurance. You have one life to live. Do not live as though it is a dress rehearsal and you are just practicing and you can get it right the next time. No, strive for that endurance and lean into all that the Lord wants to do in and through this moment right now. If you were supposed to have endurance 100 years from now, you would have been born and walking through a trial 100 years from now, but God has you alive, has you alive today, for this moment, for this purpose, for you to learn something right here, right now that he wants to use in and through you, not just for you, but for others that you're going to encounter, because the trials that I have faced and experienced where I have built endurance have helped me walk through trials and testing with other people to say, you know what? I've been there. Man, I walked through something so similar, and your feelings are not wrong, and you are human, and there's nothing wrong with you, but I want you to know the Lord built this in me, and I became greater in faith in this way because of the trial, and I believe the Lord's going to do the same thing for you. And so the trial and the endurance that he's building in you right now is for your effectiveness today and in the future. I love what that writer of Hebrews 12 says, and he says this in verse 1 through 3. He says, so throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and the perfecter of faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and he sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. So consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. So I want you to know, as you're building endurance, as you are developing that so that you can have the greatest effectiveness, you have a Savior who has gone before you, who endured the ultimate race of endurance. He is our coach. He is cheering you on. He is perfecting your stride. He is there saying, job well done, at the end of the race. So he is our help and he is our wisdom in this. And so that's why, and the next thing that we do to have joy in the trial and temptation, we can look to God and we can be filled with faith. This is what he says in verse 5-6. And he says, but if any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all generously without reproach, and it will be given to him. I love how James describes these three things about God's nature when it comes to wisdom and asking him. He says, he gives wisdom to everyone who asks, that he gives wisdom without reproach, which means he doesn't make you feel dumb for asking for wisdom. And he says, God gives it generously. So he doesn't just give it in a little part. Man, he gives wisdom abundantly to those who ask, and he is glad to give it. This is who God is. And then James tells us who we need to be when we ask, and that is we need to be expectant. We need to expect that the Lord will answer our prayer when we ask him for wisdom. When we waver, we're allowing our problems to become bigger than who God is, both in our eyes and in our hearts. And so James is saying, I don't want you to elevate your problems bigger than God. I want you to keep God as the biggest thing in your life. And do not waver or be filled with chaos and confusion. But God's will is simply that we be filled with faith, that he will be generous to answer our prayers and to give us wisdom on how to walk through these trials, to build endurance for greater effectiveness. And James ends this section by reminding these Christ followers that the blessings of God do not always look like the world expects them to look. I had an uncle who patented this kind of plexiglass material. And he was a very wealthy man. And when he died, he actually encapsulated his casket with money and coins inside of this plexiglass material. And it's in some kind of museum today. But here's the thing. This man died and was buried, and his money went as far as the ground. The thing that we think will be with us for eternity, it stops here on earth. It is not eternal. And so James is saying, I want you to celebrate the small things that are not material. The rich man can rejoice in his being brought low, and the humble man can rejoice in being brought up. It is the great equalizer, because the thing is, the world does not operate as the kingdom operates. And so James is saying the reward that God gives is not like anything else that we see on this earth. Our reward in Christ is for eternity. The temporary things of this earth will pass away. They do not go to heaven with us. So I want you to seek your reward in heaven. And this is how he ends it in verse 12. So blessed is the man who perseveres under trial. For once he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. So I'm going to encourage you today to lean into the training, to build your endurance and to be filled with faith, because the reward for all of this is so much greater than anything we will ever see on this earth. It's better than a momentary flash. Our reward is eternal.